In 1071, the Byzantine Empire decided to put a decisive end to the constant attacks that their Anatolian territories had to suffer from Turkic raiders. This was nothing new for the Byzantines. They had faced numerous challenges from nomadic Turkic groups throughout the centuries. But standing across the battlefield this time were the Seljuk Turks, Central Asian steppe warriors who were invigorated by their acceptance of Islam and the capable usage of their horse archers. Taking place near Manzikert in modern-day eastern Turkey, the battle would have a significant impact on shaping medieval Middle East. This is the Battle of Manzikert in 1071. This video is part of a two-part series with useful charts, who will be getting viewers familiar with the Seljuk family and dynasty by using the Asian royal family tree that he himself designed and sells. I'll leave the link to his video and website where you can purchase the epic family trees yourself. I myself have 4 of them. And make sure to hit the subscribe button to Hikmah History to keep updated with awesome collabs like this one. The Seljuks were from the Oghuz Turkic tribal confederacy that had established a domain near the Aral and Caspian Seas in the 8th century. Towards the end of the 10th century, a member of the Oghuz by the name of Seljuk split off with his own clan and eventually converted to Islam. Only time would prove just how important these two actions were, because by the time of Seljuk's grandsons, Chagri and Toghril, the Seljuks, who I'm sure by now you're aware were named after the man, Seljuk, moved into Khorasan at the expense of the Ghaznavids of Afghanistan, who they decisively defeated at the Battle of Dandanakan in 1040. After that battle, instead of pursuing the Ghaznavids beyond the Hindu Kush to the south, the Seljuks decided to move westward into Persia. From there they moved into Iraq, freed the Abbasid Khalif from Buyid control, and subsequently their leader, Toghril, married the daughter of the Abbasid Khalif. In 1063, Toghril died, and the Seljuk Empire would be led by his nephew, Alp Arslan. A capable military leader, Alp Arslan left much of the administrative handling of the empire to his talented vizier, Nizam al-Mulk, whose contribution to the Seljuk's success is very tough to undermine. The new Seljuk Sultan worked to expand Seljuk authority into the Caucasus region of Armenia and Georgia. These campaigns would be connected to Alp Arslan's ambitions for Anatolia, a traditional stronghold of the Byzantine Empire that was protected by military fortresses in eastern Anatolia that stretched from the Black Sea to the Mediterranean Sea. Key fortresses in the Lake Van area in eastern Anatolia, such as Manzikert or Malazgirt, fell to the Seljuks. In 1067, Alp Arslan raided vital Syrian cities such as Antioch and Edessa, and even went so far as to raid Anatolian cities such as Caesarea. By 1068, Seljuk raids into their territories had become a massive concern for the Byzantines, and they sought a decisive conclusion. So Romanus Diogenes, a capable general, was chosen to be the Byzantine emperor in 1068 with the aim of putting an end to the Seljuk incursions into Byzantine Anatolia. Romanus Diogenes' reign started off promisingly enough for the Byzantines. In both 1068 and 1069, he went on campaign with his army to the Syrian and Armenian frontiers, even recapturing some towns such as Manbij in northern Syria. But both years he had chased after raiding Seljuk armies, and both years he failed to get a decisive face-off he so desperately wanted. With the Turks often choosing to escape to fight another day, even if that meant leaving their loot behind. Now it's important to bear in mind that the Seljuks actually had another rival in the Middle East. The Shia Fatimid Khalifat was the religious rival of the Sunni Abbasid Khalifat, of which Alp Arslan was the protector. Politically, the Fatimid Khalifat controlled Syria, a contested space that was not only wanted by the Byzantines but also by the Seljuks as well. In this kind of a dynamic political environment, the Seljuk Sultan would have been wary to start a two-front war against both the Fatimids and the Byzantines. So when word came to Alp Arslan that Romanus Diogenes wanted to pursue negotiations for a treaty in February 1071, the Seljuk Sultan gladly accepted the prospect of negotiations. At the time, Alp Arslan was in northern Syria fighting against the Fatimids. One thing that made these raids particularly bothersome for the Byzantines was the fact that not every single one of them was ordered by the Seljuk Sultan. The nomadic makeup of a Turkic tribal confederacy meant that smaller clans within the Seljuk state had a great deal of autonomy. So even if the Seljuk Sultan Alp Arslan promised to stop raiding, it would be almost impossible for him to prevent every single raid into Byzantine Anatolia, because certain tribesmen could just take action without the Sultan's consent, because this was just part and parcel of a tribal confederacy. He wanted to use the peace negotiations as a ploy to mask his real intentions, which was to capture strategic fortresses near the Lake Van area in eastern Anatolia, such as Manzikert. Romanos Diogenes left Constantinople in March 1071 and made his way towards the Armenian frontier. But the Byzantine Emperor's desire to catch Alp Arslan by surprise was foiled when the Seljuk Sultan's scouts informed him that a significant Byzantine army was on its way to the Van region. Sultan Alp Arslan abandoned his campaign in northern Syria and hastily moved into Persia to recruit more soldiers. The speed and mobility at which the Seljuks were able to move would play a decisive factor in the eventual result of the battle. For this, Alp Arslan, like so many Turkic leaders before and after him, relied heavily on his horse archers. Emperor Romanos approached Manzikert and divided his troops. Roughly 50,000 of his soldiers stayed with him to besiege and eventually capture Manzikert, whilst he sent some 30,000 soldiers to the western banks of Lake Van so that they could intercept the Seljuk Sultan, who the Byzantine Emperor thought would be making his way from Syria. But Alp Arslan, reinforced by his soldiers from Persia, surprised the Byzantine force sent out to meet him because he came around the eastern banks of Lake Van and ended up being behind the Byzantines. After a short battle which we know very little about, the Byzantine force retreated back to central Anatolia, leaving the main Byzantine force under Emperor Romanos to fight the Seljuks alone. Having secured Manzikert on the 23rd of August, the Byzantines went out to meet the Seljuks on the battlefield for the decisive battle that Emperor Romanos had so desperately sought. On the 25th of August, the battle started out as a sort of a dance that began after the Byzantine Emperor rejected the Seljuk Sultan's calls for peace. The same day, the Emperor's Turkic mercenaries deserted him to join their fellow Turks. To make matters even worse for the Byzantines, when Romanos sent out messages to the 30,000 troops he had sent to the western banks of Lake Van, he received no answer. Of course, we know that they had fled to central Anatolia, but he wasn't aware of that yet. That day, there would be no fighting, as Romanos waited in vain for his other contingent of troops, and both sides decided to make camp for the night. The next day, August 26th, the Byzantines emerged from their camp in battle formation. Dividing his army into four sections, Emperor Romanos commanded the center group, which included the famed Varangian Guard, whilst the wings consisted of multinational mercenaries. The Byzantine rear was headed by a member of the Dukas family, which was feuding with Emperor Romanos. Entrusting a rival with such a massive responsibility would prove to be catastrophic for Romanos. The Seljuks were organized in a crescent shape that best complemented their archer and cavalry heavy approach. So when the Byzantine center pressed forward towards the Seljuk center, which was commanded by Sultan Alp Arslan, the Seljuks simply avoided fighting by using the typical steppe tactics of hit and run, but at the same time trying to encircle the Byzantines with the wings of their crescent formation. With nighttime fast approaching and little headway being made in battle, Emperor Romanos ordered a retreat back to the Byzantine camp. But this is where disaster awaited him. Confusion spread in the Byzantine forces about the Emperor's orders. This was compounded when the Byzantine rear, led by the Emperor's rival, treasonously ignored their duties to cover the Emperor's retreat and simply left the battlefield. The Seljuks found their opportunity to strike. The Byzantine wings were targeted first, and after they were routed and decisively defeated, Alp Arslan surrounded the last remnants of the Byzantine force, the center under the command of Romanos himself. By nighttime, Seljuk victory was assured. Emperor Romanos was taken captive and brought before Sultan Alp Arslan. After a post-battle ritual, where the Byzantine Emperor was made to kiss the ground with the Sultan's boot on his neck, Alp Arslan treated Romanos very well. They signed a peace treaty which enabled the Seljuks to gain many important forts and towns along the frontier they shared, including Manzikert, Edessa, and Antioch. The Byzantines also had to pay a monetary fee in reparations. To strengthen relations, there was to be a dynastic marriage between the Sultan's son and the emperor's daughter. Alp Arslan wouldn't really get to enjoy the fruits of his labor though. In 1072, on his way towards further conquest in his ancestral Central Asia, Alp Arslan was assassinated by a prisoner. He was succeeded by his 17-year-old son Malik Shah, who under the tutelage of his and his father's vizier, Nizam al-Mulk, helped the Seljuk Empire reach its greatest heights.
As for the Byzantines, they were set to experience a turbulent decade ahead. After the Seljuk Sultan released Romanos, the Byzantine Emperor would find that his position in his capital was no longer tenable. The Duca's family, who had played a role in ensuring Byzantine defeat at Manzikert, had installed another emperor in Romanos' place. After a brief civil war, Romanos was defeated and died after horrific injuries caused by him being blinded.
The reign of Romanos' successor, Michael VII, was filled with devaluing the currency, fighting off mercenaries that marched on Constantinople, the threat of the Normans, and above all, political intrigue in the capital. It was only when Alexios Komnenos came to power in 1081 that the Byzantines regained stability. But by then, the most important consequence of the Battle of Manzikert had made itself all but too evident. Much of Anatolia had been overrun by the Turks. This was a remarkable feat considering how central Anatolia was to the Byzantines and the fact that it took place in around a decade or so. By 1078, Suleiman ibn Qutulmish, who founded the Seljuk Sultanate of Rum, an offshoot of the Seljuk Empire, was able to add Nicaea, less than 100 kilometers away from Constantinople, into his domain. There would be some ebbs and flows. The Komnenian dynasty was able to momentarily halt Byzantine decline in what's known as the Komnenian Restoration. But ultimately, the door to the permanent Turkification of Anatolia was now wide open. And it was this concern that led Emperor Alexios to call on his Christian brethren in Western Europe to lend a hand against Turkic encroachment, leading to what was to become the First Crusade. I hope you guys liked that video. I'm a big fan of Byzantine history, so I had a bunch of fun making this video. And if you're as big of a fan of Turkic dynasties as I am, please check out Useful Charts' video on the Seljuk dynasty. I know you won't be disappointed. In the meantime, make sure to subscribe because I have a lot of really interesting videos and collaborations coming out in the near distant future. I've also recently started a newsletter that I'll link in my bio. And if you want to help Hikmah History grow, make sure to check out the Patreon page. Until next time, peace.